for about 12 meters.
Oh.
It was.
Welcome everyone to Quail Ridge Church of Christ. We do have some visitors with us. You're welcome. If you would fill out a visitor's card, leave that on the pew. It'll be picked up later. We want to invite everyone back for our evening service at 5 p.m. And also on Wednesday, we have two opportunities for Bible study, one at 10 a.m. and one at 7 p.m. If you would, at this time, silence your electronic devices so they won't go off during the service. We want to remember our sick, Glenn Fan, former minister at East Fraser, has stage 4 prostate cancer, is requesting prayers. And Steve Elrod is also requesting prayers for his health issues. Nell Pewitt is at home and doing better. Is her relative still staying with her for now? Okay, so I want to remember Nell. We also have others that are at home not feeling very well. I want to remember them. Please also remember our shut-ins, Tom and Joyce Stidham, David Marshall, Lawanda Slayton, Diane Shelby, Jim Hamm, Curtis Macklin, Elaine and Joe Sharon, Pat Swanson, Sue Simpson, and of course, Neil Pewitt and Bobby Stevenson. Please pray for these and those that minister to their needs, that they might have a comfortable life. Please check your mail in your mailbox. There are new heart-to-heart pamphlets on the table in the foyer. Please pick one of these up, one or more of those up to distribute and to read. It's currently time for the Tennessee Children's Home Spring Food Drive, and the boxes are ready in the foyer, and the list is on the table in the foyer for items that they need. They will be here April 19th to pick up those items. There will be a secret sister reveal on April 30th, and details will be coming soon. And that's all the announcements I have. Let's be prepared to, as we begin our worship, with singing.
Our song before the opening prayer will be number 72. 72.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. The Lord gave me path, I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. to heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Would you bow with me this time, please? We deep thank you again, Heavenly Father, to have this opportunity to be able to come here at this hour, sing praise unto thy name, and study another portion of that word. Heavenly Father, be the speaker of the hour, Brother Willis. Give him a ready recollection of these things which he has prepared, Heavenly Father. As he speaks this hour, Heavenly Father, he may prick the heart to those that may have never obeyed the gospel. Heavenly Father, be with the elders and deacons of this congregation also as they lead this congregation. May they always look to that word, Heavenly Father, and looking for guidance. Be with the sick that we just mentioned, Heavenly Father. Be with the doctors and minister to these loved ones and return to the one place in this life. Be with us now, Heavenly Father, as we go through this service. May we do and say things that would be pleasing our sight. For our name we pray.
Before we take the Lord's Supper, we'll sing number 3. Number 3.
Alas, and in my Savior bleed, and in my Sovereign die, would he default that sacred hand for such a one as I? At the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for Christ that
God, thank you for this time that we can gather around your table. And we We thank you for this bread, which represents your Son's body that was hung on the cross for remission of our sins. Help us to take it in a pleasing manner. In Jesus' name, amen. Likewise, Father, thank you for this fruit of the vine, which represents your Son's blood that was shed on the cross for remission of our sins. Help us to take it in a pleasing manner. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before we give back a portion of our earnings, we'll sing the first verse of 216. 216. 216.
Take my life and let it be. God's a great Lord to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love.
Please bow. Dear Lord, thank you for all of the material possessions that you've blessed us with, the ability to earn a living. We ask now as we give a portion of that back, that we do so in a cheerful manner, and please be with the elders as they disperse these funds. In Jesus' name, amen.
For our lesson of the hour, we'll sing 278. 278. Ms. Cavini, would you please stand? 278.
Father, in the morning unto thee I pray, let thy loving kindness keep me through this day.
Invitation song is number 31. 31.
Again, it's good to see you this morning. Those visiting with us, we are thrilled that you are with us and hope you'll come back at every opportunity. Numbers chapter 13, beginning with verse 30, says, "Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go at once and take possession, for we are all well able to overcome it. But the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go against the people, for they're stronger than we. And they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land, which they spied out, saying, the land through which we've gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature." To say we're living in a time of doom and gloom might be an understatement. We've been talking about wake-up calls, and there's a lot that goes on in our life that tends to be those wake-up calls. I think as we've gone through the last several years, we would say that there's been a lot of doom and gloom that has been presented, and some of it real, some of it legitimate. There's a lot of doom and gloom that's even going on in our day and age, to where it frightens us. As we look at the unrest in places like Ukraine, that I hope our prayers are constantly with our brothers and sisters there this day. As the week goes on and the threat continues, but as we look at that and we listen oftentimes to many things with the news media, that seems to be the prevalent theme with the news media, is the old Chicken Little theory, the sky is falling. And I guess sometimes, again, things are legitimate. As I've mentioned to you before, in the years I spent in radio journalism and broadcasting, I can tell you that the philosophy then, and I'm sure it still is now, if it bleeds, it leads. Meaning that's the story that people seemingly want to hear about. The gory details, the the things that are death or close to it. And so when we talk about doom and gloom, we talk about a time to wake up. The children of Israel certainly fell into a category of oftentimes moaning, groaning, complaining, or even doubting that God would do what God said he would do. Now, Joshua and Caleb were different than the other ten. We know that. As students of the Bible, we know that Joshua and Caleb were the two that said, well, God said do it, so we have to do it. And I guess when we talk about the news media or we talk about anything else, we know there are those we've always had in our life that never seem to see the good. They never quite see the positive side of things. It's always, again, doom and gloom. It's always the sky is falling. And for the child of God, that's just not the case. Even if this guy happens to fall, as children of God, we have something much better waiting for us, don't we? That's why Jesus said, don't fear man that can destroy just the body, but fear God that can destroy both body and soul in hell. And so we have a choice every day that we wake up whether we're going to live our life filled with this negativity, a life filled with the thoughts of doom and gloom, whether or not we're going to go positive for the day or we're going to go negative. We've all had those folks in our life that we'd present something positive and they would counter with something negative. And I think that's probably why there are those that never wake up spiritually. We've talked about different individuals, and we'll continue to do so on Sunday morning, about the wake-up call. There are those that woke up, but there are those that didn't. And when you look at so many, for instance, of the children of Israel that didn't wake up, even though they had witnessed miracle after miracle, they had experienced things that they wouldn't be able to explain from a physical or an earthly standpoint, so it must have been God, and yet many of them could still turn and say, well, I don't think we can do that. I don't think we can take the land. I don't think we can do what God has told us to do. And we look at that and we frown upon that. And yet there are many that are living their lives in the same manner today. We've seen the things God can do. We've witnessed the blessings in our own life. And yet what happens? What happens? Certainly we know there are bad things in our world, and we know that bad things happen to good people. God didn't promise us that they wouldn't. As a matter of fact, when we look at example after example in the Bible, we see that, whether it's the example of Job or so many others. We talked about Joseph being thrown into the pit Wednesday night, which seemed like, from Joseph's perspective, I'm sure at that point in time, when he's thrown in the pit, sold off, went to Potiphar's house, went to jail, I'm sure it seemed like, what's going on? I'm trying to serve God. And it's just one thing right after the other. And so he didn't see necessarily the providential hand of God pushing him along. So I know that bad happens. And we know that there's evil in the world. Job 14:1 says, man who is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. And so all of these things happen. The Bible reminds us there are good things to think about as well. Philippians 4 and verse 8, Paul says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praiseworthy, meditate or think on these things. Some of the biggest problems we have within the church today is a thinking problem. Like those two out of the 12 spies who didn't think they could take the land. They didn't think it would be possible. There are many today within the Lord's church that don't think they can serve or don't think they can be obedient or do the things that God has commanded to be done. So we can see where there is oftentimes a big problem in the way that we think, in our attitude. And that certainly occurs when we look at these things. So when we talk about doom and gloom, not only does it have to do with thinking, but it has to do with a failure on our part to focus and stand on the promises that God has provided us. As I've said before, one preacher said one time, instead of standing on the promises, so many today are just sitting on the premises. And the things when it comes to church, when it comes to our spiritual life, our faithfulness, our commitment, it's an involvement. It's not something we sit on the sideline and are simply spectators. It's not something that we simply come together 1 or 2 hours a week and warm a pew. It requires an action on our part. So we don't want to be like these 10 spies. We don't want to be like these 10 spies that only see the doom and gloom, only see the negativity, only emphasize what we can't do. Sometimes even as a congregation that's small, we say, well, you know, we can't do this. Well, let's stop talking about what we can't do, and let's start talking about what we can do. As spring is approaching, and spring always brings about the new beginnings, the idea of things waking up once again. As Christians, let's wake up. Let's emphasize and let's put a priority on the things that we can do, not on the things that we might be limited in doing for a variety of reasons. Because it's easy to fall into that trap, and it's a trap for the last several years. It's been real easy to fall into. We can't do this and we can't do that. So, what are some of the causes of our thinking? When we talk about doom and gloom, what are some of the causes of that attitude? Well, again, number one, the wrong focus. What are you looking at? What are you focused on? What are you thinking about even at this moment as you worship God today? As we study from His Word, as we look to a new week, what is your focus? Is it on the things of God? Is it on the things of Christ? Is it on what I can do to bring glory and honor to God this week? When we talk about our eyesight, our spiritual eyesight, some have lost it. Some have lost it. And some have lost it because they've allowed the world, much like Demas, who Paul said, has forsaken me, having loved the present world. Many have lost their spiritual eyesight because they've allowed the things of the world to come into play. Faith or fear? I have begun working on a series for a gospel meeting that I've been asked to do in the spring entitled Faith or Fear. Faith or Fear. Moving the church forward, doing the things that we need to do and moving the church in the right direction is going to have to involve more faith than it does fear. Fear has its place. Faith in Almighty God takes a greater precedent than fear in our life over what may happen, what may occur. And so our focus needs to be proper. It needs to be on what's going on. Again, if we dwell on what we're being told, for instance, on the news, all we will ever see is this doom and gloom. If we focus on what we hear in the media, all we will ever see is the bad side of our community, is the bad side of our country, is the bad side of whatever it may be that is negative. They're going to accentuate that rather than the positive things that are going on in this great world that we live in this great country that we live in. The second thing would be forgetfulness. Many of us were brought up in the church. Many of us have never known anything else from our childhood. Numbers 13, 30, and 32 were, remember, Caleb quieted the people before Moses, said, let us go up once and take possession. And of course, again, the people said, we can't. The majority of the people said, we can't do that. They're giants. Of course, Joshua and Caleb said, we must do that. Again, it seems like the people forgot. The majority of them did, at least of those 12 spies, they simply forgot. They forgot what they had seen. They forgot what God had done or what God was doing. And the same thing is true today. So many are forgetting what God has done, what God is doing, and what God has promised to do for the faithful. They've simply forgot. We can't forget how blessed we are. Even with the difficulties, even with the calamities and the problems that go on around us, the good still far outweighs the bad. And the fact remains that God's in control. No child of God, no matter what's happening in this world, should ever doubt that God is still in control, because He is. And we've got to remember, as we sing the song, "This world is not my home, I'm just passing through," this isn't a permanent dwelling place for us. But we've got two choices where our permanent dwelling place will be: heaven, which is a prepared place, and hell, which is a prepared place. And we've got to determine here and now which one we intend to inhabit. And so we've got to remember, when we talk about why do bad things happen to good people, one of the reasons that these things occur is God doesn't want us to get too comfortable with the temporary dwelling that we are occupying at this time. He doesn't want us to get too attached to this old world. He wants us to be able to know that better place. The third thing is far-fetched goals. Again, oftentimes when folks look through the scriptures, they look at this idea of perfection as a sinless perfection on your part and my part. And as I mentioned in class, if that were possible, then Christ wouldn't have come. God wouldn't have sent His Son. His Son wouldn't have willingly went to the cross if it would have been possible for us to keep the law and the commandments perfectly. So, because there are those that expect sinless perfection, then you have those, whomever they may be, who say, "Well, because I can't have sinless perfection, I won't try whatsoever. Because I can't be sinless, I can't be perfect, then I'm not even going to try." No one is perfect except the Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. No one. And so when we put somebody up, whomever it may be, preacher, elders, I don't care who it is, on a pedestal, all we're doing is giving them a whole lot further distance to fall when they fall, because oftentimes they do, because they're human. We've got to make sure that the goals we set aren't unrealistic goals. Oftentimes, the first of the year, when we talk about the New Year's resolution, we folks set goals, and then within a very short period of time, they quit. Why? Well, maybe because the goals they set were unrealistic. Folks, we've got to take baby steps before we can take the big steps. We've got to crawl before we walk. We've got to walk before we run. We've got to do these things in order. And so to jump right into it and set unrealistic goals and expectations, even when it comes to the growth individually or the growth of a congregation, can be extremely dangerous if we're not prepared to do so. We want to please God. We want heaven as our home. And we can have all of that. By the grace of God, we can have those things. By the love of God, we can experience those things. The fourth thing is destructive words. Children oftentimes grow up hearing destructive words. They hear, "Oh, you're dumb," or "You'll never amount to anything," or whatever it may be. And we almost see self-fulfilling prophecies that occur because of that. Because of that. Never going to amount to anything? So sure enough, they don't. Because they never get out of that mindset. When we talk about being clumsy, or we talk about being failures, this can all, again, become self-fulfilling prophecies. When we go back to the children of Israel, They, like you and I, have a choice. They had a choice. Either to serve God or to be disobedient. You and I have that choice, to serve God or be disobedient. We look at places like Joshua 24:15, where Joshua says, "For me and my house, we're going to serve God." Joshua had a choice. As we go through the wake-up calls that we're talking about in both the Old and New Testament, each one of these individuals or groups of individuals had a choice. God has given you the choice and He's given me the choice. So how do we conquer? How do we overcome? How do we wake up after we've gotten such a comfortable rut of doing things the way that we've been doing? Well, first of all, commit the scriptures to your life. Don't just read them, or don't just memorize them. Live them. Satan is going to attack. Satan's not really interested in attacking the world. He's already got them. But Satan is interested in attacking you because you're trying to serve Almighty God. Never forget those old paths. Never forget the saints of old. Never forget the things that have been set before us to make life easier. And maybe in some ways, it's become too easy. We've become lazy because it has become so easy. And most of all, I think it's, who are you listening to? We've got to stop listening to man so much and start listening to God more. And when we do that, then our attitude and our actions will certainly be what they need to be in that way. Understand the power of prayer. When we're facing doom and gloom in our life or as our country or whatever it may be, let's face it with prayer. Let's face it with understanding the power, because that's following the example that Jesus set forth in his prayer life, or the Apostle Paul in his prayer life. If we'll rely on the Word, if we'll rely on the words of Almighty God, they'll never let us down. They'll never disappoint us in any way, shape, form, or fashion. But we've got to recognize the power that's there and not simply rely on our own strength. Would you bow with me? Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we are indeed thankful for the power of prayer and the communication that we have with you. And we thank you for the communication that you have with us in your word. Father, we approach your throne of mercy this hour, thinking about the unrest that's going on in our brethren in Ukraine, and Father, the unrest and the threat of war, and we pray, Father, that cooler heads might prevail in the days ahead, and that things might be settled in a proper way so that bloodshed will not occur and death will not occur and destruction, and that these cooler heads might come to an agreement and be able to settle these differences. Father, we pray that you'll go with us from here today and that you will watch over us. We thank you again for your son, Jesus, and we ask this in his precious name. Amen. If you're subject to the invitation this morning, please don't delay. If it's becoming a New Testament child of God or coming home to be a faithful child of God, we want to help you in any way that we can. If you'll simply let us know while together we stand and sing.
All things are ready, come to the feast, come, for the table now is spread. Ye famishing, ye weary, come, and thou shalt be richly fed. Hear the invitation. Come to the feast. Come.
Song is 220, 220. We'll sing the first verse. Appetite will lead us in prayer. Hope everyone will come back tonight for our 5 p.m. worship service. 220, first verse, appetite will be dismissed.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then wherever you go. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. I offer the blessing of your service bestowed upon us. Thank you for the time to come here and hear another great lesson from thy word. Hopefully, we continue to apply to our daily walks of life. Here's to the ones that were sick and the ones that have lost loved ones recently, and prompt them to tell me you came.
Good job, Ricky.